I'm Ling Shi Cheng, Environmental Law Fellow at ERI, and I'm so pleased you're able to join us today. Both IPE and ERI are founded on the understanding that interdisciplinary learning and research are essential to teach today's scholars and solve today's problems, not to mention tomorrow's. Natural sciences, social sciences, the humanities, and the arts are all critical and in play as we tackle climate change and the environmental challenges that are affecting our health, our communities, and our economy here in Bloomington and around the world. IPE was founded in 2012 by the provost and the leadership of the O'Neill School, the College of Arts and Sciences, and the School of Public Health to bring together all the environmental and sustainability scholarship across the various schools and departments on the Bloomington campus. ERI was founded in 2017 as part of the IU Prepared for Environmental Change Grand Challenge. Its mission is to enhance resilience to environmental change in Indiana and beyond by accurately predicting impacts and effectively partnering with communities to implement feasible, equitable, and research-informed solutions. IPE and ERI faculty, staff, and students have worked together to bring us a full semester worth of speakers. Over the course of the semester, our speakers have addressed a wide range of topics from resilient agriculture in the face of climate change to advocacy and energy transition, to the development of an anti-racist science of ecology. So this is our last talk of the semester, and you'll be able to find information about each talk on the ERI and IPE web pages and in the regular newsletters and upcoming events notices that our organizations regularly send out. And we also encourage you to sign up for our newsletter so you'll get reminders about these upcoming talks next semester, as well as other news and events we will publicize. So if you have ideas for people we should consider for a future talk, please let us know that too. Finally, logistics on how you can engage with our speakers today. You can put questions into the chat box as you think of them. We will monitor them throughout the speaker's talk, and there will be an opportunity for questions at the end. So at long last, let me please introduce today's speakers. So I'm really happy to introduce Elizabeth Brennan Browning, who is the Western Indiana Community History Fellow at ERI. Dr. Lizzie Browning is a U.S. historian whose environmental history research examines how Americans have thought about and engaged with environmental issues and built narratives around these experiences, particularly through the lens of environmental health and social justice in the 19th and 20th centuries. She joined ERI as the Western Indiana Community History Fellow after receiving her PhD in history from UC Davis. And let me also introduce Maria Whiteman, who is the Artistic Social Practice Fellow at ERI. Maria Whiteman received her Bachelor of Fine Arts degree from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill and her Master's of Fine Arts degree from Pennsylvania State University in Visual Art and Mixed Media. Maria's multimedia work engages with animals, landscapes, and fungi, and her goal at the ERI is to create visual entry point for people to approach the sciences through a visceral, emotional experience. And their talk is titled Hoosier Lifelines, Environmental and Social Change Along the Monon from 1847 to 2020. And they will be introducing their collaborator, Richard Koenig. So let me turn on over to you, Lizzie and Maria.
Thanks, Lingxi, for the introduction, and thanks everyone for joining us on such a beautiful Friday afternoon. I wanted to thank Lingxi and Sarah Mincy, Jonathan Hines, and Vanessa Worthy for all your work bringing together the ERI speaker series over the past semester. It's been a really wonderful, enriching experience to hear from those speakers. And today, I'm going to present a little bit about the Hoosier Lifelines exhibition, and then hopefully in questions and answers, and then Maria Whiteman will present on her artistic work. And in the Q&A, one of our collaborators, Richard Koenig, is here, and I'm not sure if Eric Sandweiss is here, but hopefully that you'll be able to hear from them as well. So I want to start with acknowledging and honoring the Indigenous communities native to this region and recognizing not only Indiana University Bloomington, but the whole stretch of land that the Monon Railroad passed through. So we recognize that Indiana University Bloomington and the former Monon Railroad are built on Indigenous homelands and resources. We recognize the Chippewa, Delaware, Kaskaskia, Kickapoo, Miami, Ottawa, Peoria, Piankashaw, Potawatomi, Shawnee, and Wyandot people as past, present, and future caretakers of this land. And I want to start I'm not going to be talking exactly about the exhibition right away. I want to share, but I am going to show you footage from it as I talk about something else. So let me share my screen here. Bear with me. Let's see. Okay. And let me hit play on this. And so are you able to see this full screen? Okay, great. So this is footage, drone footage from the Monon Railroad from New Albany in the Ohio River Valley, up through the town of Monon, which is less than 2,000 people in the Corn Belt and Soy Belt of Indiana, all the way to the north of in Michigan City along Lake Michigan sand dune. So I wanna have this, I thought this would be a great backdrop for me to talk about infrastructure because there's a lot of infrastructure in this footage here. So it was really striking when working on this exhibition and thinking about talking to you today. You know, we're talking about the legacy of Indiana's railway and infrastructure more broadly. And I wanted to take an opportunity to begin with a few reflections about President Biden's recently unveiled American Jobs Plan, which would devote over $2 trillion to our nation's infrastructure. So first, I want to situate us in our current context of thinking through and debating exactly what infrastructure is. Here we are in the town of Monon, and I apologize if it's a little choppy. I've tried to work through this, but it's smooth on my end, so I'm hoping you're seeing a smooth video feed. But throughout my discussion, I really want to emphasize that I'm approaching infrastructure from two critical angles. First, the importance of reducing carbon emissions, and second, rebuilding with racial equity at front and center. In early March 2021, the American Society of Civil Engineers graded U.S. infrastructure at a C-, and in 2019, the World Economic Forum ranked the U.S. 13th in the world for overall infrastructure. So there's much improvement that needs to be done. And it appears likely that the Biden administration's plans will face steep Republican opposition. It may seem tempting then for policymakers to pursue an apolitical strategy when it comes to infrastructure. But American history has shown that this strategy is impossible. Infrastructure is integral to defining political belonging, and it's always shaped tensions between private capital and public welfare. Biden's plan calls for spending and tax credits devoted to rebuilding 20,000 miles of roads, repairing bridges, eliminating lead pipes, building a clean electric grid, amplifying internet broadband access, and providing affordable housing, schools, and workforce innovations. It's quite broad, as I am sure you've all heard about. And I think this is a signal moment for the climate movement, and really a once in a generation opportunity to shift our national infrastructure toward more resilient and just ends. The plan, as you've heard, would move the nation to cleaner energy sources, and it recognizes both the devastating impact that climate change has had on our nation's infrastructure and how our systems of infrastructure have in turn contributed to carbon emissions. In the last year alone, the United States faced 22 extreme weather and climate-related disaster events with losses exceeding $1 billion each. So this was a cumulative price tag of nearly $100 billion. Chronic underinvestment in resilience has harmed American transportation infrastructure. It's disrupted service, making travel conditions unsafe and causing severe damage and increasing maintenance and operating costs. So I'm actually gonna switch over to my PowerPoint as I continue here. So let me share that screen. Okay, are you all seeing that? Yes, great, okay. I'm gonna skip through here. So here is a visual of that 2020 billion-dollar weather and climate disasters across the country. You can get a sense of the scale of that. So moving forward, we also need to pay heed to building racial equity within our systems of infrastructure and addressing injustices and how these systems were designed and how they've operated over time. You can see here the construction of Interstates 65 and 70 in Indianapolis. And these passed through areas that had been redlined. And redlining was a discriminatory practice that began in 1933 with the formation of the Homeowners Loan Corporation. And they deployed this color-coded scheme to designate risk for mortgage lending. So neighborhoods that were shaded in red were deemed hazardous, and people living there were then ineligible for government-backed home mortgage loans. On this map, you can get a sense of where people were displaced and homes and businesses were demolished. And you can see it was about 17,000 residents and 8,000 were displaced and 8,000 buildings demolished. And this was primarily Black and brown neighborhoods and lower income neighborhoods. So the American Jobs Plan includes $20 billion for a new program that will reconnect neighborhoods cut off by historic investments in infrastructure and ensure new projects advance racial equity. So when we look at these funding proposals, I want to focus in on transportation, the majority of which is focused on our roads and providing incentives for electric vehicles. As you can see, that's a big portion of the transportation spending. But there's also $85 billion for existing public transit and $80 billion for railways. And this would be the biggest investment in rail travel in more than a generation. And it has the potential to bring public commitment to rail transportation back in line with levels of investment that road and air travel have received over the past decades. The New York Times recently reported on these investment disparities and how they have helped contribute to a dominant car culture in the United States. Over the past 65 years, the US has spent nearly $10 trillion in public funds on highways and roads, and just a quarter of that amount on subways, buses, and passenger rail. Since the early 1980s, Congress's transportation bills, which amount to multi-billion dollar investments every few years, in these bills, the vast majority of funds have gone to highways and roads, about four-fifths all told. And this makes sense on paper. As you can imagine, about 80% of Americans' trips are by car or light truck, compared to just 3% by mass transit. But the historical patterns of government commitment to roads and highways, which largely began with the creation of the interstate highway system in 1956, this has much to do with why our cities and suburbs are sprawling environments that require a car to get around. And this is also a big reason why transportation is the sector most responsible for greenhouse gas emissions. Nearly 30% of America's greenhouse gas emissions come from transportation, largely the millions of gasoline-burning cars and SUVs on our roads. And there's a more recent report from 2019 from the EPA that shows transportation at 29% of greenhouse gas emissions. So it's gone up since I found this figure. So when we're looking at the American Jobs Plan, I'm really interested in the rhetoric that's, you know, gone into this and the framing. They recognize, the designers of the American Jobs Plan, the architects, recognize that modernizing public transit is going to help us tackle both carbon emissions and racial injustice. Households that take public transportation to work have twice the commute time, and households of color are twice as likely to take public transportation. And then when you quantify the backlog of what needs repairing, we see over $105 billion in need of the amount that we need for repairing. And this represents more than 24,000 buses, 5,000 rail cars, 200 stations, and thousands of miles of track signals and power systems in need of replacement. We also need to invest in reliable passenger and freight rail service. The Biden plan recognizes but, you know, unlike highways and transit, rail lacks a multi-year funding stream to address deferred maintenance, enhance existing corridors, and build new lines in high potential locations. Clearly, Amtrak is thrilled from this proposal. There's a lot of fanfare for them. Of course, you know, the Northeast Corridor is a big focus between DC and Boston, that's such a well-traveled corridor right now. But there's much of a need in the rest of the country for this kind of rail transit. So Amtrak is the largest passenger rail provider in the US. And it's said that it plans to expand service and upgrade existing tracks with as many as 30 new routes And it hopes to expand ridership from 32 million to 52 million passengers by 2035, which would amount to an important decrease in greenhouse gas emissions. So I've talked about the Northeast Corridor and its steady ridership, but you know, if you were to try and get from Cincinnati to Chicago, if we're talking kind of close to home here, there's only one train per day between Cincinnati and Chicago, and the train departs at 1:41 a.m. in the morning, and the trip takes 9 hours. So it's just not a very attractive option for passengers. In June 2019, Amtrak canceled the Hoosier State train, which is between Indianapolis and Chicago, after the Indiana General Assembly voted not to approve the $3 million a year needed to keep the train going. This left the only Amtrak option between central Indiana and Chicago as the Cardinal, which operates 3 days a week. Amtrak projects that with Biden's funding plans, connections for Indianapolis would include increased service to Chicago, new routes to Cincinnati and Louisville. Although there's been some outrage that if you look between Indianapolis and Nashville, there's this missed opportunity to connect the South and Midwest here. This is just a really interesting to kind of imagine the future of what this could look like. Amtrak also touts, you know, rail is a lot cleaner than air travel and car travel. So traveling by rail, it's up to 83% more efficient than driving, and up to 73% more efficient than flying. When it comes to freight, railways are critical to Indiana's economic operations. And the next few slides I have are from the Indiana Department of Transportation. They're in the process of updating their state rail plan, which federal law requires that each state does this every 4 years. So we can get some great real-time data on freight in Indiana right now. So in 2019, Indiana's manufacturing industry accounted for 27.4% of state GDP. And this is nearly three times higher than the US average and the highest of any state. You can see here that freight rail accounts for 13% of freight tonnage in Indiana. And trucking is by and far the winner here at 63.7%. Industries that rely on rail to be competitive include automotive, chemicals, metals, grain, and mining, both coal and limestone. And it's really interesting to also look at freight flow by commodity and direction. We know that Indiana is a state that's historically relied on coal, and that coal-fired power plants have provided some of the highest levels of carbon emissions in our state. It was really enlightening conducting research for this exhibition to track the freight tonnage of coal through the Monon Railroad's annual reports. It really conveyed how extensive Indiana's reliance on coal has been over the course of the 20th century. And this is a great map from the Geological and Water Survey in 1958. It gives you a sense of the movement of coal within the state. In the southwestern portion, the mining, and then the coal-powered generating plants around the state. It's important to note that Indiana, you know, in 2018, it ranked seventh in production for coal and second in consumption, trailing only Texas, which is four times as populous as Indiana. But, you know, despite how much Indiana produces, it imports a lot of its coal from elsewhere. Many of Indiana's coal-fired power plants were not outfitted with costly equipment that would remove the high sulfur content of southwestern Indiana's bituminous coal. So Indiana's power plants and power companies have historically relied on lower sulfur coal, lower cost coal from the Powder River Basin in Montana and Wyoming. Regardless of where the coal is coming from, Indiana's stretch of the Ohio Valley continues to have one of the nation's highest concentrations of super polluters, which are facilities with the steepest rates of combined toxic and greenhouse gas emissions, much of which is from these coal-fired power plants. But we know this reliance on coal is changing, Recently, IDOT forecasted that coal volumes will decrease by over 35% between 2018 and 2045. And these losses in coal tonnage will be more than offset by growth in metal, food, farm, petroleum, and chemical products. So I think as the state moves toward cleaner sources of energy, it's going to be really telling to keep an eye on coal freight tonnage in the state and see what takes its place. IDOT anticipates that hazardous materials are projected to grow at 1.2% annually. So here's just a brief look at where Indiana ranks in terms of how much it relies on rail today. You know, for being a relatively small state, rail makes up a big part of Indiana's economy, and it's how it just moves freight around, really. It's fourth in the number of freight railroads, 11th in total rail line mileage. So it's kind of remarkable to see that. Okay, so now that you have the lay of the land when it comes to our contemporary reliance on rail and its importance to our current debate about infrastructure, I want to introduce the Hoosier Lifelines exhibition in some more detail here. So the exhibit really began as a discussion with myself, Maria Whiteman, who is the ERI Artistic and Social Practice Fellow that you heard about at the beginning from Lingxi, Betsy Sturrett, who is the IU Grunewald Gallery of Art Director, Eric Sandweiss, who is the Thomas and Catherine Miller Professor of History at IU Bloomington, and I'll introduce Richard Koenig here in a minute as well. So here at IU Bloomington, we were talking about the rich literature of the Anthropocene or the capitalist scene, and trying to figure out how to bring that literature to the people of Indiana, that that concept and that thinking. So the exhibit has two deeply interconnected parts. First, the historical context that considers the Monon's underlying interconnected parts, the underlying environmental, economic, and political contours. So the first part is the historic context. And then second, the photography that documents the places that the Monon reached, looking for new ways for us to connect, make community, and resituate our relationship with natural resources. So the artists who photographed the landscape were Betsy Sturrett and Maria Whiteman. And then Betsy introduced us to Richard Koenig, who is the Genevieve U. Gilmore Professor of Art at Kalamazoo College. And Richard grew up in Bloomington. He received his MFA here at IU Bloomington. And he has a deep knowledge about the railroad and a beautiful portfolio of vintage work that relates to the railway from his time living here. So it was really a privilege to get to work with him on this project. The exhibit is this historical and artistic examination of Indiana's landscape, and it's traveling to two sites on the former Monon line. So it started in Bloomington at the IU Grunewald Gallery, and it's headed next to New Albany near Louisville, and that will be in from July to October. And the exhibit uses the old right-of-way as a means of building a new understanding of the interplay of local landscapes, ecosystems, and social communities across time and space. So you can see here, this is a map from 1904, and it shows, at the time it was called the Chicago, Indianapolis, and Louisville line, and it had over 100 stops and over 600 miles of rail entirely within Indiana. Here's a cleaner look. This is from 1954, the Monon Annual Report. But to give you a sense of the history, it started as the New Albany-Salem line here in the South. So Salem was not too far away, and that was in 1847. And then it was built up to Michigan City by 1854. And here at the X in the main branch lines is the town of Monon, which was platted by James Brooks, who was the first president of the Monon Railroad. So the town of Monon is literally, you know, just comes straight from its history with the railroad. And then you have the branch line to Chicago. There's also a spur line to French Lick. And this spur line was more related to coal production. Part of our project was looking at these old bird's eye view images of these main towns along the Monon and then seeing how that compares in contemporary photography. Here's New Albany. Here's Michigan City. This is a Indiana State Board of Tax Commissioners railroad map, and it shows you just how extensive rail was in the late 19th century in Indiana. And this is a 1957 Monon annual report map that also shows this sense of connectivity that, you know, people, residents of Indiana had. These main rail lines came through Indiana, connected with the Monon. You had the Cleveland, Cincinnati, Chicago, and St. Louis Railway, which was known as the Big Four, the Nickel Plate, and the B&O Railroad, among many others. Here's the Pullman Palace car route to Florida and New Orleans. So the marketing and the imagery from the Monon is really great. You have the Lifeline of Indiana serves the nation. This is from 1955. So you really get a sense, you know, again, the Monon was entirely within Indiana, but it just brought, you know, the rest of the nation to Indiana. There was even marketing for how you could travel to Cuba along, you know, lines that the Monon connected with. So I think Hoosier's imaginings of other places really came alive. This is a great map for, in terms of thinking about Indiana's connections to Chicago, and then Chicago serving as the gateway to the West. This is the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy Railroad. And it's also worth mentioning here, even though this isn't something we really addressed in the exhibit too much, the vast electric interurban system that centered at Indianapolis and connected small towns across Indiana in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. The first electric streetcar railway opened in South Bend in 1888, the first electric interurban in Indiana, I should say. And this was 1888, and it grew extensively over 15 years. By 1910, there were 12 companies operating direct lines between Indianapolis and major cities within a 120-mile radius. By 1914, Indiana was second only to Ohio in terms of interurban mileage in the US. This really started to decline around World War I due to the rise of the automobile and motor buses. The Great Depression was, you know, the final blow to their dwindling presence in the state. And the last interurban closed in 1941. That was between Indianapolis and Fort Wayne. I love this map too. This one caught me off guard when I found it. This is showing Indianapolis as a steam railroad and interurban center. It talks about, you know, 1/4 of the population of the United States is within a radius of 300 miles of Indianapolis. So, you know, the Monon, the story we hear about it within the state, it's a story of economic development and technological progress, and there's no doubt about that. The Monon catalyzed, you know, countless industries and allowed people to travel like they had never been able to before. And this is what we heard when we went to various museums around the state, when we met with, you know, avid collectors of Monon memorabilia. But a lot of these popular narratives about the railroad leave out the fact that this economic and technological progress and our historical success has come at a steep price. And this is really environmental degradation. So the railroad crystallizes for us the ways that we've depleted finite resources that we depend on for our way of life. And in the process, how we've altered in unprecedented ways the planet that we live on. The former Monon Railroad then has become this anchor by which we can explore the connectivities among people, industry, and commerce within Indiana and beyond. And it opens a window into the history of Hoosiers' interactions with their changing environment. So the exhibit's artists really provide this visual entry point that allows viewers to understand the mental landscape that we encounter our world with and how we've come to expect to see our world and how this framework then shapes our valuation of various environments. Just trying to work in a few images from the artists. You'll see more from Maria in a little bit here. The railroad made logical certain forms of production that we've all come to take for granted: monocrop industrial agriculture, the lumber industry and the deforestation of the state, extractive industries of coal and stone, and major urban and industrial centers that have connected smaller towns and suburbs, as well as more isolated rural areas. So I want to play a brief clip here to give you a sense of how the Monon, you know, advertised itself, how people around the state thought about its importance. And this was a promotional film from the 1950s that the Monon Railroad developed here. So let me get it set. There we go.
All up and down the line can see how the railroad has helped to create American prosperity. Farms producing great quantities of pepper be fully marketed without modern mass transportation. Factories which assemble their raw materials from a lot of far-flung points and send their finished products everywhere. Towns and cities in which people have grown used to buying things which are brought from all over the world. Our way of life, which is literally a product of railroads at work. Take these factories which make prefabricated houses. Their lumber comes from as far away as the Deep South and the Pacific Northwest. Their steel begins as iron ore from the Minnesota range, ore which is converted in some of the world's largest mills located in northern Indiana. Countless other items have to be shipped to this from hundreds of different places in order that one complete house can roll off the assembly line. All up and down the railroads of America, this miracle is repeated and repeated. Railroads are not the only transportation used, of course, but because of their tremendous capacity, their unfailing reliability, and their basic economy, they are the backbone of American industry and American agriculture.
They went over the top with their marketing, which I appreciate as a historian. It's been fun to go through their archives. So clearly, you know, the railroad, it's been critical to shaping the landscape and how it's been envisioned. And I think it was striking for me to think, you know, this was largely an arbitrary line on the landscape, but over time it became this vector of connectivity. It's a cultural touchstone that people continue to remember today with great fondness, and it was an economic linkage. So this simple line became a remarkably significant thing within our state and beyond, and it's had such great consequence for social development and cultural prominence. And this past year, you know, it was really this sense that, you know, we can't take the world that we have for granted anymore. So this was tied not just to climate change, but to COVID. And COVID presented such an abrupt and deep rupture in our social fabric. So I think it was really interesting to work on this exhibition over the past year. And my fellow curators and partners who worked on this exhibition, we looked at these various questions. I think the exhibit raises more questions than it answers, really. But we were wondering, you know, what will replace the energy-intensive network of labor and industry and the communities and workers that once brought our state together? What will sustain our communities in a time of accelerated environmental change? And what becomes of the future that we once imagined for ourselves? Part of the inspiration for the exhibition was engaging with public audiences that the Environmental Resilience Institute might not have had the opportunity to reach yet. I wanted to bring Hoosiers into this space to talk about climate change, hopefully not elicit, you know, a knee-jerk reaction to that. We had the opportunity to partner with a number of cultural and history-oriented organizations. We worked with private collectors, and we had loans from various IU archives. So it was a lot of moving parts, but was really rewarding. Okay, I want to transition to Maria here. So I'll go briefly through these slides. But again, I think what the exhibit does is it takes a step back from this narrative of universal progress with the railroad. And we want to think about, you know, what the railroad meant for various people. So I love this Thoreau quote from Walden in 1854. If you jump down to the bottom, he questions, you know, if we do not get out sleepers and forge rails and devote days and nights to the work, but go to tinkering upon our lives to improve them, who will build the railroads? We do not ride on the railroad, it rides upon us. And then you can look at Eugene V. Debs, a native of Terre Haute, Indiana. As he reflects on his path to socialism, he talks about, this was in as a youth in the 1870s, he worked on the railroad as a locomotive fireman. And he went on to become America's most prominent socialist. He was a five-time presidential candidate in the early 20th century, and he twice earned nearly 1 million votes. And so Debs, in 1902, a journalist asked him, you know, how he became a socialist. And he says, I rode on the engines over mountain and plain. I was with their boys in their weary watches at the broken engine side and often helped to bear their bruised and bleeding bodies back to wife and child again. So how could the seed of agitation fail to take deep root in my heart? So given these more critical views of the railroad, I've been wondering some of the populations that did not benefit uniformly from the Monon. And I think if it's enlightening to look at the marketing of the Monon, this was in 1946, they really embrace the image of indigeneity within Indiana. And this was kind of a common trope that railroad companies did in the mid 20th century, this sense that the railroad was tied to the land in a very profound way. But we have to step back and think about the construction of the Monon. It wouldn't have been possible without Euro-American settler colonialism. And this was part of this was the violent dispossession of indigenous peoples. So the exhibit talks a little bit about how this dispossession took place. We have to think about the landscape, what that was before the railroad and before this contemporary time that the railroad has made. Another kind of interesting point was that the Monon brought tourists to Prophetstown near Lafayette, where the Battle of Tippecanoe was commemorated in 1811, and the Shawnee leader Tecumseh died at the hands of William Henry Harrison's army. So we talk about indigenous lives here. We also, another story of resistance and the inequities of mobility, broadly conceived, is the Underground Railroad. There's often this misconception that, you know, the Underground Railroad was an actual railroad. It was not, but in the case of the Monon, escaped slaves who crossed the Ohio River used the tracks of the Monon to make their way north to Salem and beyond. And again, the first president of the Monon, James Brooks, he was a Republican who is believed to have offered freedom seekers passes to ride the rails in their efforts to travel further north. And we can also talk about the Great Migration, where between 1916 and 1970, millions of African Americans left economic deprivation and racial discrimination in the Jim Crow South for northern cities. And the Monon was one of those routes. The railway, you know, also offered opportunities for limited employment. There were Black Pullman porters who provided vital labor on sleeping cars, dining cars, and parlor cars. And they were really the catalysts of the civil rights movement. So a few more images of the Great Migration here. I also became interested in thinking about how, you know, public health has been the intersection of the history of public health and transportation. So looking at how epidemics were handled on the railway, I think COVID shaped my interest in that. But I was looking through the pages of the Defender, and there's this really striking story in 1923. The St. Louis Health Department stopped, you know, when passengers arrived at the Union Station in St. Louis, there was a forcible vaccination campaign that was happening with Black migrants. And there's the story that a train with African Americans arrives to Union Station. The physicians are trying to vaccinate them, and migrants are escaping from there. They're not submitting to this vaccination campaign. So I think it's striking to think about the rail in more than just how it was built, but kind of the social connectivity, the history of what it meant in all facets of life. So bringing in the context of race and social history, the history of environmental justice, it's integral to understanding the full history of the railroad and every aspect of life that it was a part of. So I'm gonna do this last bit before I hand it over to Maria. I found this study from the IUPUI Fairbanks School of Public Health. This was a study of the Indianapolis metropolitan region and life expectancy along the Monon Trail. So the former Monon Railroad, which is now like the B Line Trail here in Bloomington, a path for runners and bicyclists. And life expectancy drops in the north here. This is around Noblesville. It drops by 14 years once you get to the south, urban core of Indianapolis, just south of Monument Circle. So you can see, you know, inscribed in the land still are these social legacies of the infrastructure that the Monon was a part of. All right, I'm going to stop my screen share, Maria, and pass it to you. I think you're muted, Maria.
That happens. So I want to thank Lizzie for asking me to be part of this project. I was really honored to be part of it, and I am really pleased with the outcome of the project. And there was so much in Lizzie's narrative that I thought deeply about, and it resonated with me as well. And so to try to think about how, as an artist, I can visually represent this project in a fine arts way and an aesthetic way that would reflect a lot of Lizzie's thinking. And so again, it was such an honor to be part of this. So I'm gonna also share my screen. It's gonna be a little strange at first, but hopefully it'll work out. This always happens. So hold on. I have to wait for it to show up. Let me do this again. And okay. Here we go. Okay. Can you see that? Okay. Yeah. Okay. Great. Okay. My dog's barking. She times it so perfectly. I have three sections of work in this exhibition. And each one to me spoke about a different connection to the railway that I thought was really important. Each section of my work addresses key environmental changes Indiana has experienced over the last two centuries. The railroad figures prominently in these transformations. The Monon facilitated the rise of the timber and limestone industries in the 19th and 20th centuries. Today, the former Monon line carries wind turbines, blades for installation in agricultural fields in central and northern Indiana. And I'm just going to go through this. A sign of shifting regimes of energy production following the tracks of the old Monon, the most striking realization is that the vast stretch of Indiana's monocrop agriculture, the fields of corn and soy, were once vast stretches of deciduous forests. While the standard narrative of the railroad's historical development in Indiana is one of unwavering progress, my work considers what this development meant for those who could not access the fruits of American capitalism's profits. The railroad allowed greater mobility and spurred economic development, but these benefits were not universal. Environmental changes have affected all of us. There was a time when Indiana was 93% forest before the railroad and industry became the main economic driving forces. As the industrial world shifts and market demands increase, the small farms disappeared and the agri-industry transformed the landscape. Monocrop farms in Indiana colonized a horizon made of wind power stretching across the landscape, and wind turbines sit on the train beds ready to be installed to generate power. Presently, coal companies are diminishing and green energy is evolving. So this series of photographs are obviously of these wind turbines that are sitting on the railway train beds. And what I liked about the images, I'm just gonna go, is you can see behind a lot of the grain elevators. So it was an interesting dichotomy to catch in this moment of an old idea and farming to this new idea that could possibly be saving some of the farmers because they can lease their land out to these wind energy companies. And so you have this futuristic looking metal turbine coming in and then this older history behind them. And it was just a perfect moment to capture the old and new and then to think about a carbon neutral future. So the second section of my work is called Displacement. Indiana means land of Indians, a place where many indigenous cultures thrived and lived off the land. Before Native Americans were displaced by pre-European settlements, they protected the land and lived a sustainable existence. Part of the Shawnee and Tecumseh's promise to his followers was that if they followed his instructions to abstain from the influence of Euro-American culture, deer, bear, and wild animals would return to the forest. The Monon Railroad ran by Prophetstown State Park and the Tippecanoe Battlefield, where today stands a memorial in commemoration of Governor William Henry Harrison, who defeated the Prophet and his followers. So this piece took me a long time to really think about how I wanted to represent this history and also talk about the different industries and the history of industries in Indiana. And so I decided to take the images, which are photo collages, and I wanted the project to feel sacred, or this part to feel sacred. And so I start with, the piece begins with roots and trees to narrate visually how the past and present are tied to the railroad and how the Hoosier Lifeline project conveys how industry, history, and nature cohered in moments of displacement and resistance to climate change, So I start with roots and trees to think and to remember and to reflect how Native Americans lived off the land. And then the boxes with the images inside them is to create something sacred. So not only is this history sacred, but the land is sacred and how it changes in the transformation of the landscape. So you can see the boxes are underneath. And then there's these different portraits. So here's Tecumseh, and here's his very famous quote. And here's the Prophet, who is his brother. And this is around the Wabash. This is around the Wabash and Tippecanoe. So this is where the battle took place. And I also wanted the trees to signify something important too, because we often read about how trees, how many of the trees have been here for hundreds of years, the trees that are left. And in this area where the battle took place, there are trees there that are very old. And to imagine that that had been witnessed this whole battle, and yet the trees still remain. So then this last piece, I'm gonna make this quick because I know we're running out of time, is called Resistance. And this particular piece is called The Gospel Train. And I'm gonna play it for you. And I just wanna read a small piece of this because resistance, the Monon paralleled another form of resistance in Native American history, eventually the Underground Railroad. The network of secret routes followed some of the same routes as the path that became the Monon. The codes and signals exchanged between freedom seekers helped make the nocturnal passages, secret deliveries, and improvised paths possible. Its passengers and its conductors alike traveled in great danger, sometimes in the shadow of rail tracks being laid from the New Albany north. So I'd like to play this. Can you see that? Can you see that? Yeah, okay. So I'm gonna play this piece and make sure it's on. Hold on, oops. Let me just make sure it's playing. Oh, it is, okay.
Doesn't look like it's playing, Maria.
It is. This part just took a little
while. Oh, it's like, okay.
I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. There it goes, I see. Okay, so that's that was my part in the exhibition and working with Lizzie. And so I'll stop there because I know we only have a few minutes left.
if anybody has any comments or questions.
Thank you so much, Maria and Lizzie. That was really fantastic. So we have a few questions, but I think we only have time to discuss one. And I'm going to have to pick the one from Ranjan, which is really, I think, thoughtful. So he writes, I'm interested in the dissolution of the Monon and what that might say about the direction of development in the US. Particularly urbanization and increased density are in many ways one of the most sustainable strategies for society to develop. But that is in some ways in opposition to the world that the Monon supported, lots of smaller communities. So do you think something culturally important is being lost and we should try and move back towards that world, or does the shift reflect a more positive development?
Thanks, Ranjan. That's a great question. Yeah, you know, I think in working with the various partners and collectors to make the exhibition happen, so much of it, of the exhibition, is about the memory of the Monon and how it did bring the state together and these small communities. So there is a very much this backward looking element and the sense of nostalgia. But what I hope, you know, Maria's work especially shows that, you know, not we need to recognize both the positive and negative aspects of the rail, the environmental degradation, the fact that it didn't serve all communities. And I think it's just very poignant that the American Jobs Plan is coming out now as I'm thinking about the exhibition, because, you know, there's a big question about what role rail is going to play moving forward. I don't know if Richard Koenig's on the line here, Eric Sandweiss as well, and Maria Whiteman, if any of you have thoughts about the role of rail moving forward. You know, a lot of the infrastructure is there. It just needs retrofitting in a lot of ways. And there is an opportunity to be, to contribute to less greenhouse gas emissions through the use of rail. So I think there's a real opportunity there, but I think a challenge is, climate justice. Is it really going to serve communities that need it? Is high-speed rail something that is really going to be an equity-focused development? So that's an outstanding question that still puzzles me.
Maria, do you want to add on to that at all?
Yeah, I would say, I think that's, especially Lizzie, when you showed the chart about how much money is going to be spent on infrastructure and to see money being spent on public transportation and trains, I think it's going to have a lot of impact and I think it'll be really important, because when you think about railroads or you think about passengers taking the train, it integrates a lot of, it actually makes diversity more possible. And because people of all different classes and thinking about different races are taking the train. And so integration has more potential. And so that's one reason I think that it would be also something to think about. And so to go back to Rajan's question too, I think culturally, yes, it could make a big difference. Keeping that in mind.
Well, thank you for that very thoughtful response to a very thoughtful question. And so we're at the hour mark. So I'm gonna thank Maria and Lizzie for that fantastic talk, as well as their co-collaborators, Richard and Eric. And thank you all for joining us for our final ARI Speaker Series talk. We hope to see you next semester. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Take care.
Take care.
Thanks so much. Bye-bye.